Okay, we talked about the idea of learned regression, went through some of the assumptions and the basis for it. And so let's go ahead and find a linear model for the Finger Lakes data that we've been working with. Now, I want to determine the appropriateness of the model. That means I need to look at a scatter plot, make sure I'm convinced it's reasonable linear to begin with, and then address all the assumptions and make sure I can actually use the model. And if it's okay to use the model, I'm going to use the model to estimate the number of dead fish with a pollution index of 10. And another pollution index of say 13.75. Typically, this is how regression is used. You create a model, then use the model to predict what would happen with different values on of the predictor variable, whatever you have on the x-axis. And then I want to talk briefly about this value of R squared, which is referred to as a coefficient of determination. We'll talk about that. You'll see it in the output, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. So let's go ahead and start off doing a scatter plot, and if the scatter plot appears to be linear, then I want to continue and actually build the model. So we've already looked at the scatter plots, but let's do it again. Let's take a look at pollution index, which would be our predictor variable. We're going to use it to predict deaths, and then do a quick graph, and we'll look at this and yeah, that's reasonably linear. So that says, yeah, let's go ahead and take a look and do a regression analysis. So I'm going to put Pearson's correlation on there. I don't need Spearman's, and now I need to turn on store residuals. I need these residuals, and grayed out here you see residuals. It's going to create a column called residuals to keep those error terms in because I need them. And then the null alternative hypothesis for correlation is fine, so I will graph it. When I tap on regression line, that is the equation we're going to see in just a moment. But this is the least squares regression line that was calculated for this data. So now if I take a look at results, there's a bunch of information here. I'm not going to get into this. There's some information in your text if you look at it, but we know that B0 and B1, that's the B0 is the y-intercept, and that has a very significant p-value at 6.47 e negative 6, which is 0.000006. And the slope of regression line is 0.0005. So we know that it's significant. Now, what we want off of this are these two values because this is actually telling me what my regression equation is. So again, the scatter plot looked reasonably linear, so we're okay there. The linear trend exists, so I'm going to continue and actually build the model. And this model will look like y hat is equal to 111.9577. And then you look back on here. And look for that's the value of B0. B1 is 9.6075. X in terms of thinking in terms of like algebra. Now, what I want to do is I actually want to call this deaths. Hat, the predicted number of deaths is 111.9577 plus 9.6075 times the pollution index. So, see, that's how you pull the model off of the output from TC Stats. It says estimate and gives you the B0 and the B1 estimates. Now, this R square is 0.8623. What does that mean? Well, what that is saying is that if you look at the variability in deaths, and you look at the variability in X, that's saying that 86% of this variability is explained by the X value. In other words, the level of pollution is explaining approximately 86% of all the variability in the deaths that we're seeing. The higher that number, the better. If this is lined up in a perfect line, so the R was equal to 1, then we'd have 100% of the what's happening with deaths being explained by the pollution index, what's going on the x-axis. That's what that R squared, the coefficient of determination, actually means. So now I need to think in terms again of my assumptions. So what I need to do is notice this new column here called residuals. This contains all of my errors. So I'm going to start off by looking at a normal plot of the residuals. And this is a little bit disconcerting. I don't think this is all that normal. There's some issues here. So there may be a problem in this particular example with using this data for regression purposes. Now I want to take a look at a scatter plot, and I want my pollution index to be my x-axis and the residuals to be the y-axis. They came up opposite, so I just tap right here on switch order. Now I have it the way that I want. I'm going to turn all this stuff off because this doesn't do anything for me. It has nothing to do with what I'm about to do. Now I graph it and I'll take a look here. And what I'm seeing is what I could be seeing appears there may be some curvature here. I see low, then are negatives, then positives, and then a negative value. Quite often I'll take a look and say, hey, look, if I can put one dot in here, will that change it? Then actually it does. So, you know, reality, the variability may be okay. But it still looks like I'm autocorrelated. So what this is telling me is that there's a definite possibility that what looked like linear data may actually have had some curvature to it. If that's the case, I really can't be producing confidence intervals for my predictions. I can predict off of it, but now to try to put a strength of prediction to it is probably not a good idea because of the variability issue and the lack of potential lack of normality. Now remember, we wanted to predict the deaths based on a pollution index of 10. That was one of them. So this would be 111.9577 plus 9.6075 times the pollution index of 10, and that gives me 208.0327. So the best estimate would be approximately 208 fish deaths being recorded if the pollution index was 10. See, we also want to look at 13.75. So that would be 111.9577 plus 9.6075 times 13.5, which gives me 241.65895. So roughly 241, 242. Now there's one more thing I want to point out. This estimate is probably okay when I estimated for 10. This is a huge problem. And the reason being, if I go back and look at my data, my pollution index has a smallest value of 1.3 and a largest of 11.6. And I just estimated using a pollution index of 13.5. Now the issue there is when I look at a scatter plot, the smallest value I said that I had was 1.3 for pollution index, and the largest was 11.6. And roughly we saw what we thought might have been linear, looked at later and said, eh, you know, this could be curved. But the point is we're thinking originally that we had some type of linear trend between 1.3 and 11.6. Now I come along and say, I'm going to come up here at 13.5 or 7.5, I don't remember what it was, doesn't really matter, it's way up here. And I'm going to use this regression line that we calculated to estimate the number of deaths based on this pollution index. But I don't know what my data does up here. In reality, this data, if I had a higher pollution index, it may take a sudden, very sharp turn. It could start going exponential. I don't know. Because you don't know what goes on here, this is not a good idea. And the term is, we say, do not regress. In other words, don't use a regression line outside the data range and I'm going to make this generic of x, whatever we have on the x-axis. We don't want to regress outside there because we just don't know what's going to happen. So this would be a very bad thing to do.